The remake of Karate Kid is much better than the first one.
I will hurt you. No! What?
Welcome to Up, Up, Down, Down. I'm your host, Austin Creed, and today on Superstar Savepoint, we got a good, good brother with us. Ladies and gentlemen, this man has traveled the world. He knows more about action and horror movies than possibly anyone that I've ever met in my life. Ladies and gentlemen, let me introduce you to Dalton.
Can I hold this up and just say, I want to change my name.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
Wow. What's brought this upon you?
So I'm the biggest Patrick Swayze fan in the world, and I love Roadhouse, and I love Dalton in Roadhouse. But then I found out it was Breeze's SCW name, and I just it's kind of sucks on me now. So it's like I don't want to look like I'm a mark for Breeze or anything. So can I just be Spud?
100%.
Okay, yeah. Just everyone calls me that anyway, so I'd rather just sorry Swayze, sorry like. It's all Breeze's fault. Breeze's fault.
Okay, well, we're going to play RoboCop 2. This falls in line directly with with your jam.
God,
let's go. Okay, Spud. So we've talked about like how you love action movies, and you were... I love that you were disgusted at the podcast tournament that we had.
So disgusted. Like, it officially confirmed to me, like, Kofi's the worst. the new Day in general, the worst. Big E, the worst. Like, your decisions on things. I was like, what? Like, yours was like, I mean, this was the worst one. Yeah, me and my dad watched this one together, The Matrix, so it was like, you know, the coolest thing ever. But like, yeah, that beats Die Hard. No!
100% it beats Die Hard.
No, it does not.
Matrix over Die Hard all day.
No!
What makes Die Hard better than The Matrix?
You want me to go? Okay.
Let's talk.
Okay. You got a dude, right? He's just an everyday dude who's got everyday problems. He's got family problems. He focuses on the job too much, and he's got to go see his wife. So he goes all the way to Los Angeles.
Ex-wife,
at
right?
Christmas.
Is it ex-wife?
No, it's not his ex-wife. Ex-wife. No.
But they're having problems.
But they're having problems, and he knows that these problems are bad because when he gets there, he goes, "Yeah, I'm here to see Holly McClain." And Holly McClain's not in the system. And then he goes to a maiden name, Holly Gennaro, and that's what she's under. So now he's like, it's just an everyday dude, got family problems.
Well, also, can I jump in there? So my first issue that I see there is, so clearly this guy sucks,
right? No, he's just a dude that's just a little bit too focused in the job. It's kind of like, from there, who else was gonna save the entire building but this guy that's just happened to be there to see his wife, and he's just took his socks off because some dude on a plane told him, you know what, if you want to relax after a flight, make some fists with your toes. So he's just chilling, making fists with his toes, took his sock off and relaxing. All of a sudden, terrorists, but he happens to be a police officer with a special set of skills before Liam Neeson had a special set of skills. So he's just one of the best action movies of all time, and at the time as well. If you want to talk about babyface and heel psychology and what a good guy is, you want to be John McClane. You're rooting for John McClane the entire movie because he's a flawed character, and we're all flawed people. So he's just getting it done. He's just getting it done, and you're rooting for him. And the fact that he's walking through glass in barefoot. He's hurt. He's tired. No one's on his side, but like Alan Rickman's a way better actor than him as well, and he could have got all his cool lines in, but Alan Rickman's like, nah, man, that guy's a babyface. It's the best film ever. Not a Christmas movie either. And you know what? And
if what? It is,
it's an every day of the year movie, not just a Christmas movie. It's an every day of the year movie. It can be whatever you want. What button?
I don't know. All of them.
This is awesome.
We back them up.
This game is awesome.
We are RoboCops. We are RoboCop. Yeah, crush him. Crushing him? You could just crush him in the car?
They're gonna... Yeah, Nick.
Oh my god. Oh my god. They're just gonna crush him inside the car. What? They just killed a man. he just said, well, we'll just crush you.
Your move, creep.
Yeah, let's go to Nick's Guns.
Nick's Guns.
Okay, so while I will say, obviously, like, fantastic movie. Incredible movie.
Gun.
You got three shots left. You got two shots left. You got one shot.
Sorry, I got a gun.
So you get one. Gun. You get another one. A little Randy for the gun.
Oh, you can throw people.
What? Press slam, dudes? Oh, this game is great.
If you press circle on the pad, you just grab people. Boom. Okay. Boom. Oh, this guy's got loads of shots.
Oh, here we go. Oh, the Chainsaw Boys. Chainsaw Boys.
Yeah.
Here we go. Oh, God.
Dude, we just.
Oh, no. No.
Oh!
You're okay. Come on. Get him. Don't hit me. Dude, I don't like these guys. Are these guys in the movie?
No. Nothing in this game has been in the movie except for RoboCop. Oh, we got one.
Oh, no.
No, he's back.
That was
up.
Me. That was me.
Yeah, I threw him down.
Okay, here we go. Yeah, Die Hard, great movie. Yeah. Great movie. Just, I don't think it's better than The Matrix.
So, I can't remember where you guys rank RoboCop in it. I know Kofi had a bit of a soft spot for RoboCop. I remember that. RoboCop's like, so it was the one movie as a kid where, all right, this is a superhero movie, but we're going to shoot someone's hand, face, head, everything of their body off. So you can get the deal that this is a violent ass film. Well, it was by Paul Verhoeven, who did some of the best satire movies ever. Like, if you watch RoboCop now, the commercial advertising satire that they're trying to get across in there is, like, fantastic. And then he's got, like, he did Starship Troopers.
One of my favorite movies.
Yeah, and he did Hollow Man. I don't know if you've seen Hollow Man.
Yeah, it's been a while.
Yeah. But, like, the satire that he puts in his films is very similar to what George Romero does with, like, capitalism and all that sort of stuff. It's really good. Really good.
Dude, so, okay. So, do you dislike The Matrix?
I don't dislike The Matrix. I have The Matrix on 4K. Have you seen that scene where they walk into the building and it's like, beep, beep. Oh, we're just going to have to scan you down.
Oh, yeah. Guns. The guns? Yeah.
I used to watch that every day, that scene every day when DVDs first came out, because I could skip to it and be like, this is awesome.
This is incredible. I remember watching it for the first time. When you see it, it's like, you're amazed. And then you think, this will be the coolest part of the movie.
Yeah.
But then when dude is dodging bullets.
Oh, it was pretty good. And then it's Kung Fu. It had a lot in it. A lot of Kung Fu. So that was another thing with your Kung Fu movies. I'm not a Kung Fu guy.
Oh,
not
I am.
About it. I'm not a Kung Fu movie. And like you guys were really like showing off with your Kung Fu knowledge. And I'm like, I'm not too hard about that.
I think all you have to do if you are not aware as to what we're talking about, let me give you a little bit of a rundown. So The New Day did a greatest action movies thing. And like I said, Spud here knows everything there is to know about action movies. And so—
What a loser.
I'm not a loser at all. I'm the same way with dumb comedies that people don't like on Rotten Tomatoes. Yeah, so we decided that The Raid is the greatest action movie of all time. It's nonstop action and fights. Like, once they get started, it's very video game-ish. You gotta fight up a tower to get to the bad guys. It's very good. But Drake, he's not a kung fu movie guy, not a karate movie guy.
Yeah.
I think all you've gotta do is watch this movie and you'll understand.
Okay. Yes. Well, all right, I'll give The Raid a shot on your recommendation. There is a karate movie that is great, though, and that's Karate Kid. And again, that's another Kofi. So, you know what? I identify with Kofi more than I do you and E. Completely.
Really?
I'm glad that E sat down before this podcast that you did and watched Commando, though.
Yeah.
Because that celebrated 35 years yesterday.
Oh, wow. Oh, I did see that.
So Commando was made because at the time, Stallone and Schwarzenegger were just absolute, just muscle measuring each other constantly.
Oh, yes.
Like my movie a bit. So Schwarzenegger releases Commando. Oh, okay. Okay, buddy. I'll raise you Rambo. First Blood Part 2. Like, okay. Oh, you got me there. But John
it's so good.
John Matrix in Commando, like, for one liner, that's the Schwarzenegger movie. Like, he's most famous for the Terminator, but
I think people sleep on Eraser.
I wasn't a fan of Eraser. I mean, it's probably because it had an alligator in it for no reason.
Most things are in Schwarzenegger movies for no reason.
Like what?
Jingle All the Way. What is this?
Recall.
Now we're on bikes?
What? This is so awesome.
This is like 19 games in one.
This is one of the best games I've ever played.
Oh my God. And I don't know which one I am.
Oh, I know. You're the red one. I'm green. No, I'm green.
Are you? Wait, what?
No, I'm green. You're red. I'm green. You're red. You're the more robo. I'm the RoboCop.
I'm red. I'm red. Yes. Yeah. Okay.
You're the RoboCop Part 1 color. I'm the RoboCop. No, I'm the RoboCop Part 1 color.
Yeah,
you're the RoboCop
I'm on the right. I'm on the right.
Yeah, you're Part 2 where they kind of made him a little shade of blue and purple.
There we go.
So the opening of RoboCop 2, right? Like, and the trailer. If you ever get to watch the trailer, RoboCop 2, dude, I remember watching it as a kid, and the trailer came on, and it's just essentially the opening reveal of RoboCop in RoboCop 2.
What?
So good.
What is happening?
Yeah, this happened in the movie. He jumps through and gets Kane and kills him. But there's a woman in it that wants to preserve a brain to make a new RoboCop, because obviously capitalism, you got to make new everything.
You have to.
So she wants a RoboCop 2. But the problem is they couldn't find a policeman that had the compatibility like Alex Murphy did. Mm-hmm. So making their new machine, she was like, well, why don't we try this criminal's brain, this drug dealer called Kane, who was with a new street drug called Nuke. And so she put the bad guy who RoboCop just killed in our game, she put the bad guy's brain in the RoboCop 2 machine, and it worked and it was compatible. But the only way to make it listen and be compatible is if you gave it large quantities of Nuke. So that was the deal. Shoot the gun.
I'm trying.
You just got to move gradually out of the way. Of it.
Have you played this?
No, I'm just figuring it out as I go along. I got 7 credits. This is the second time I've died.
I just put all the credits in at the beginning.
Yeah.
Oh my God, stop moving.
Yeah, you're annoying me. I'll get the right one, you get the left one. Oh no, the right one's the left
one. Yeah, now they're... Okay, I'll stay over here. All right, so once they shoot, we got a time. Once they shoot, there we go, good.
Got him.
Yeah. My God.
Yeah, RoboCop 2's a little different. There's a kid in it that says lots of swear words and also becomes the crime boss as well, and he's like 13. His name's Huff. But then the kid also dies as well. It's like so violent.
But this sounds like a robotic version of Demolition Man.
Yeah, but look how accurate Demolition Man was. Like, if you look
with
at what's
seashells?
Going on. With every, no, well, not the seashells. Like,
with that, the COVID high five?
Oh, fuck.
Nobody touch.
The COVID high five, the FaceTime. You know what I mean? Like, there's so...
Oh,
like,
no!
Even, yeah, so this happens in the movie as well, because they're trying to, take... Oh, thanks, mate. I wasted it on a tank. I just wasted it on a tank. So this happens in the movie as well, where they're basically trying to get Robo... But we're chronologically out of order, because this was before Kane was killed, the way we killed him, just when we jumped through the car.
He went into the toxic waste.
This is going to be a big mutant. Yep.
Oh, no.
So this doesn't happen in the movie at all. I have no idea what this is. But good for them. They're trying.
They're like, let's do our own stuff. Source material.
Maybe they're going back to RoboCop Part 1, where the guy goes into the acid and kind of melts and everything. He's like, help me.
Yeah, that's... They're making sure that it's a callback.
Yeah, it's a little callback.
I like a good callback. Let's throw him.
The bad guys in RoboCop 1, though, Clarence Boddicker was like the worst. He was horrible.
Was that the dude with the white hair?
No, the bald guy that was like, cops don't like me.
So what am I thinking of?
I don't like cops. And then he's like, no, you're thinking of Dick Jones, the old man that ran OCP. So the old man that ran OCP was the bad guy in RoboCop 2, right?
Okay.
he was the capitalist guy that gets away with everything. In RoboCop 1, it was the old man's second, who was Dick Jones, that hired a bunch of crime lords that sold drugs. And the bad guy was Clarence Boddicker, and he was awful because he's the one that kills Alex Murphy originally. But the way he does it, he like shoots his hands off, and all the stuff he's saying is like, "Well, give the man a hand."
You're like, "See, I love that."
There's a dude in it that's got an awful laugh, and he's like, "Ah!" Like he's just like. But the bad guys have got like such unique like characteristics and stuff. Like, and then there's this TV show that constantly plays during it, where the main character is like, "I buy that for $1." And that becomes like a catchphrase of the film.
I don't understand why we ever got out of like 80s style of doing things in that sense.
I don't. And it's so right now. So I'm watching a bunch of like 80s horror movies now. So I like the ones that don't take themselves seriously, but the actors take it serious. Like Friday the 13th Part 6, Jason Lives. All the actors take it serious. Oh God, I've just game overed myself.
You're okay. You can just hit start. Just hit start. There's credits.
Nope. I game overed myself.
You know, you can put your name in. Put your initials in.
Oh, there we go. Yeah. So
we have to jump to hit it.
Yeah, okay. So this is Ed 209 from the first one.
Yeah, I was gonna say, I feel like I know this thing.
Yeah, this is Ed 209. He was the prototype before RoboCop was made from Dick Jones. And then that's when RoboCop's creator come in and goes, "Hey, I can make a better one." He was Bob Gordon, his name was. So so that's who Dick Jones was like, "No, I'm destroying this machine and its reputation and it's the person that created it." So he kills. I had to kill Bob Gordon because he made a mistake. Now it's time to erase that mistake. But RoboCop recorded that audio and played it for the old man.
Got
big
him.
Big payoff at the end. Good stuff.
How do you remember all of this?
It's just my childhood, man. Like, still now, it's my childhood. Back to the 80s films. Like, all the actors in Jason Lives, even though, like, Jason's now a zombie, the first kill is he pushes his hand through a man's chest, revealing his beating heart. And, like,
what?
And he gets a James Bond end. You've never seen Jason Lives?
I feel like I have, but it's been a long time. I have
brilliant.
A bad thing. If it's been a while since I've seen a movie, I forget so much about it.
It's brilliant. And it's like, he gets like a James Bond entrance and everything like that. It's so good. So good. Because it's not taking itself as serious as like a lot of horror. I watched a wonderful one recently because I watched this 80s horror documentary called Into Darkness. Mm-hmm. And
what's it on?
Into Darkness is on Shudder. It's on Shudder's.
There
great.
We go. We love Shudder
so
here.
Good. Yeah, I heard. I just seen a new trailer from a Shudder movie that's about two dudes that are gay and they
just
move into a town.
Oh, I watched it last week.
Is it good?
It's great. It's great.
Oh, I want to watch it.
It's great.
It looks like a Get Out kind of film.
Yes, I cannot
really
remember. Spiral.
Spiral.
Yes, it's called Spiral.
That's exactly it.
Dude, it's very interesting, especially because it's set in 1995. It's a gay couple, and one of the guys, he was married previously and has a daughter, and so it's like he's come out with his partner now, and they've got his daughter with him, and they're moving to, I want to say like in Colorado or something, and then things just get real weird.
Yeah.
Real fast.
It's exactly like Get Out, the premises. It's like where it's like, oh, these people are. I'm sure it's going to go one way like Get Out it did and then go the exact opposite.
Yeah.
So I'm looking forward to that.
Yeah.
So this movie, I want you to watch Night of the Creeps.
Night of the Creeps, okay. Can do.
Okay. And it's got it's so good. So it starts off in the 50s and it's like an old 50s B movie. Where it's black and white, and it starts off like this, and then it jumps into an 80s movie where it's like a, prom, party, that sort of stuff.
Yeah.
And there's basically the guy from the B movies part of the film has been frozen since the 50s, and in the 80s he's thawed out. So some of the one-liners in it are great. It's like, and so like there's these zombies that, because it's from an alien, of course. So these zombies are created by these slug things crawling into your. This is from RoboCop 1. This is awesome.
So just put in whatever.
Yeah. So they like so this these slugs get into the into you like by through your mouth.
Ew.
And then you become a zombie. Of course. Okay. And well, there's this
yeah.
So the cop in it is the gentleman that was in Halloween 3 Season of the Witch, and he's like, "Thrill me." That's all he says. He picks up the phone, he's like, "Thrill me." Like, thrill and no me. One knows what it means. It's just, he just says, "Thrill me," constantly. Like, someone calls him, "Thrill me." Like, "What do you want?" That's his, "What do you want?"
What is this?
But he comes
you guys
up
are saying
the,
that.
"Thrill me. I want to. I want a t-shirt that just says, thrill me."
Yeah.
Great. So then the monsters are all happening and stuff, and then basically he looks out the window because it's prom night and all these young ladies are like waiting for their dates. This is Kane, by the way.
Hell yeah, yeah. We chased him.
We got to jump and no, he's just not
jumping.
Taking,
shot.
Oh, jump. Yeah.
Yeah, we got to jump to shoot him.
So basically, he's looking out the window and he goes, "Well, girls, got some good news. Your dates are here." And they go, "What's the bad news?" "They're dead."
Oh, no. Oh, no.
Awesome. So awesome.
See, we need to just make a horror movie.
So It Follows was a good 80s kind of satire movie. Have you seen that?
Yeah.
Follows. Like, you haven't seen It Follows?
No.
Dude, incredible.
Is that on Shudder 2?
Should be.
Okay.
And if not, seek it out because it's incredible. It's very much like Halloween. So imagine this, right? You don't know what this entity is. It's just someone, but the entity just slowly walks towards you, and if it touches you, you're dead.
So,
but it could be anybody from in the street. It could be any human being anywhere. The entity is just constantly walking towards you, and as soon as it touches you, you're dead. And then it goes back, and then it would go back to, for example, my wife. You know what I mean? So,
yeah.
So, or no, if my wife gets found by it, it goes back to me.
If she gets,
you know
what
I mean?
If she gets killed, so, then it goes back to you?
Then it goes back to me. So the idea is, just like any transmitted disease, it's like, it goes on to a new host constantly.
Yeah.
But if it happens to kill somebody, it goes, you know, it goes on to somebody else. It goes backwards. So you have to keep passing it on in order for it to go away from you.
But wait, but if let's say that you pass it on,
yeah,
and then it kills that, and then someone else passes it on,
yeah,
it kills that
person,
then it comes back.
So you're two steps ahead now.
But you might think that you're like 10 people removed from it. But if this thing starts moving and killing people,
it'll still come back
to get you.
You'll never know. That's the thing.
Oh, dude, screw that. That's a terrible disease.
And it's awesome. Like, in the movie, like somebody could just appear at your house, or you could be at school, and there's just all of a sudden this old lady walking down the corridor, walking towards you.
Nope.
Yeah.
Nope.
But then in the movie, because you know that this is the premise of the movie, you're constantly looking in the background for people that are just walking. it's nuts. It's a paranoid movie. It's so good.
Yeah.
It's really good.
I just watched a good one. I think it was the Lady in the Window or the Witch in the Window or something like that.
Uh-huh.
It's about this guy. He's trying to... you'd like it. It's very Die Hard. He's on hard times with his wife and trying to reconcile and all this stuff. So he goes and buys like a townhouse, or not a townhouse, like a farmhouse. He's going to do it up because she always wanted one of those houses. Got him.
No, we got Kane. Kane's face has got to.
Oh, no.
Oh, no.
Oh, no.
Here we go. We're nearly at the end of the game, I think.
Yeah, we got to be. We got to be.
So there's going to be this big tank that drives into him soon. It's got to be.
Okay. But anyway, there's a woman who used to live there, and she would sit in the window when she was alive, and it's creepy because she'll be in like random scenes, and like you might not notice her in one, and then you see her just like in a mirror somewhere, and they don't even like focus on it. It's just if you see it, you see it, and it's a really cool cool flick. He's really making this.
You got to do a top Halloween films, you three.
Well, you know what would
that
win.
That would rule.
Halloween? I mean, Nightmare Before Christmas.
Now you pissed me off.
What does that sound? What does that sound?
You're upsetting me.
Why? A Halloween movie? Nightmare Before Christmas? There's a better Halloween movie?
Yeah, it's called Halloween.
Nah, bro.
So I just got Halloween on 4K, and it was like it was made yesterday. It's incredible.
Yeah. Halloween's incredible.
Oh, yeah.
But I mean, Nightmare Before Christmas? Nightmare Before Christmas?
What else did I watch today? Nightmare on Elm Street Part 3, Dream Warriors.
Okay.
Oh, that's great. And it's got Dokken as the soundtrack as well.
When you say Halloween movie, do you just mean horror movie, or you mean movies based around Halloween?
No, horror movie. A horror movie.
Oh, horror movie. Okay.
Yeah.
Well, then never mind. I'll take Nightmare Before Christmas off there.
I think you can, because people still relate it as a Halloween-y film, but as a horror movie...
No, definitely not a horror movie. It's Halloween-y. Yeah. If we're just going Halloween, Nightmare Before Christmas. But if it's got to be horror Halloween, I don't... Wow, get the brain. Oh, we crushed it.
Oh, we crushed the brain. Where's the brain? Oh, did Robo do it?
Yeah, he crushed it against the robot.
We've done it, guys. Now we just got to see the old man. The old man just blame everything on the woman.
Show us the
woman
that
wanted to the woman that wanted to create RoboCop 2. The old man who's the president of the company goes, see, she gets all the heat for this, and then walks off.
This is what being human is like, all about.
Because he then escapes. Patience, Lewis. We're only human. Get the drill to his head.
Oh, and we beat it.
We just did it. So good.
Hell yeah.
So
great
good.
Music, great conversation.
Appreciate you,
Spud.
Thank you for having me. Thank you for giving me my name as well.
Dude, hey, no, I can't give or take your name from you because why? Your name belongs to you.
It's mine. Yes. It's mine. Yes. Love it.
Where can people catch you on social media to keep up with you?
You can catch me on at WWE Maverick on Twitter and Instagram.
Make sure you guys are keeping up with Spud. As you can see, very well versed in the movies. Look at his wall back there. He's got a bunch of good stuff.
You haven't seen the rest of the house, but yeah, that's just a sample.
Yeah, I will say it was fantastic having you on. And my closing thought to you is that the remake of Karate Kid is much better than the first one. Keep it tight.
I will hurt you. No! What?
It's just a better movie. It's a better movie.
Disgusting. Disgusting. Right in front of him.
Bro, right I know, but I'm saying, look, at what point does Daniel ever learn how to fight, dude?
He won, didn't he? He won the tournament, didn't he?
On accident, pretty much. He swept the leg.
Listen to me. No, listen to me. It's not about fighting. Karate not in here. Karate not in here. Karate.
Yeah. Yeah, but I bet you money that someone who says karate is in here and right here is gonna beat the hell out of Daniel.
Yeah, and guess what? That's what the Cobra Kai was teaching, and it didn't work. It didn't work in Karate Kid Part 1. It didn't work in Karate Kid Part 3 either. Certainly ain't working in Cobra Kai. Season 1, 2, soon to be 3.
Well,
I bet there's a fourth.
Here's my question. So by the third Karate Kid, you'd think that Daniel could fight, right?
Have you seen Karate Kid Part 3? Amazing bad guys. I'm just
great bad
that
guys. Great bad guys.
The bet.
But Mike don't Barnes, they don't they beat him up like 3 times in one day?
No, they beat him up. So they're trying to get him to join the All Valley Karate Tournament, defend his title. But
he's out with his girl, and they jump him because he can't fight.
Well, Mr. Miyagi's like, you don't need to fight anymore. You proved your point to Cobra Kai.
All of that, yes, very important. But by the end, by like the halfway point in the new Karate Kid. He knows how to fight already. So like, I'm just confused.
But that's
he's
thing.
Hitting that nasty crane and Mr. Miyagi, incredible. And there's no one on this earth who could be a better Mr. Miyagi than the original Mr. Miyagi besides Jackie Chan. Jackie Chan rules overall. Jackie Chan's right here. Jackie Chan, you want to talk to him?
No, I don't. No, I don't. In fact, I want him to turn his back and leave because there's no way I'm ever referencing him with Mr. Miyagi at all. Never. Never. It's Pat Morisha. Pat Morisha.
Great. Sorry. Incredible. Incredible.
He nearly never got the part, you know? You know he nearly never got the part because he was a comedian and the director thought, nah, he's a comedian. He'd be too funny and people wouldn't take Mr. Miyagi serious. Whoa.
Okay.
He wrong.
Until next time, always and forever, keep it tight. Da 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 da